Good morning. It's a beautiful Sunday. Glad that you're in the Lord's house and you're here to worship. And we are glad to see each of you today. Josh, you have your son, also Josh, with us here today. Glad to have him. And we got some teenagers spent the night, so we're glad to have each of them here with us, that they had a long night, or the adults had a long night, or maybe they had a great night, but they even got a little sleep. I don't know. I never went to a lock-in where you got sleep. But they may have slept a little. All right. How about birthdays? Anybody have a birthday this week? All right. Well, let's
happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
All right, please be seated, everybody. And we're going to start off with We Bow Down today. Oops, I forgot something. All right.
You are Lord of creation and Lord. Lord of land and the sea, Lord of the heavens, the glory of the sky, Lord of all, Lord, you will be. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down. You are King of creation and King of life, King of land and the sea. You are King of the heavens before there was time, and King of all that you will be. We bow down and we tell you the King. We bow down and we tell you the King. Bow down and we tell your King, King of all kings you will be. We bow down and we crown you the King. We bow down and we crown you the King. We bow down and we crown you the King. King of all kings you will be.
All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer, everybody. Almighty God, we do bow down before you, and we worship you, Almighty God, and we come this morning and just lift up your name, Almighty God, because you are awesome and wonderful and beyond our finding out yet. Lord, you tell us to draw near to you and to know you and to know your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, we come here today with humble hearts and ask that you give us eyes to see and ears to hear what you have to say to us today, Lord. We are truly amazed, and you have done great things, Lord God. And I ask that your Spirit would move in our hearts this morning and help us to draw near to you. We pray for your Spirit to move today, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Anyone have something you'd like to praise the Lord for? Yes, Star. Yeah, praise the Lord. Okay, that was weak. Praise the Lord. Okay, all right. Anybody else have praise the Lord this morning? It's good to praise God. See the verse up there? In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus. Yes. That's right. Praise the Lord for the guys that cooked. All right. Praise the Lord. Okay, anybody else have praise the Lord? No?
Praise the Lord for being in the house of Christ.
That's right, for the house of the Lord. Praise the Lord. Okay, yes. Did they win? I didn't think they won. Huh? OBU! Oh, yeah. All right, OBU. Praise the Lord. Okay, I thought she said OU. I thought, ah. Okay. All right, anybody else have a praise the Lord today? I want to praise the Lord for my wife back there. Thank you, Lori. Praise the Lord. Yeah.
Lori gets applause.
Okay. All right. Anybody else have a praise the Lord? We ought to be grateful to God, guys. Praise the Lord for the United States of America. Praise the Lord. Okay.
Praise the Lord for the freedom of praise Jesus Christ.
That's right. Praise the Lord. Okay. Yes. All right, praise the Lord. Okay. All right, anybody else have praise today? All right, okay. We're going to sing. Were you lifting your hand, Larry? Oh, you're rubbing your shoulder. Okay. Okay, we're going to sing 142, Wonderful Words of Life. And this is going to be our welcome song, so we'll say hello after the first verse, okay? All right.
Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of wonderful words.
Hi, guys.
Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Sweetly echoes the gospel call, wonderful words of life. For pardon and peace to all, wonderful words of life. Jesus, only Savior, forever. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of love. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Please be seated. We're going to sing "You're My King." I'm forgiven, as you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven, but you were forsaken. I'm accepted, I'm alive and well, spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Is number 216, "Great is Thy Faithfulness," and this will be our offertory. So on the last verse, which is the third verse, would you please stand? God is faithful, isn't he?
Amen.
great is his faithfulness.
Okay.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions that fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercy I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 besides. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Amen. Let's pray.
Lord, again, it's just a blessing to be here, and truly your faithfulness is beyond our comprehension, Lord. We're just so thankful that you watch over us, you meet our needs, you beyond our own idea of what we need. You know better than we do, Lord, and we're just thankful for that. Just help us to just always be good servants, that we would shine for you, that we would react to all situations in a pleasing way, Lord, a way that you would have us act. And just be with Brother Larry today. Speak through him, that we, again, would all draw closer to you. And I just ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
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 Amen. you turn your Bibles, book of Hebrews, Hebrews 11. And we will read a section there, starting at verse 23. Hebrews 11, 23. By faith, Moses' parents hid him for 3 months after he was born because they saw that he was no ordinary child, and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt because he was looking ahead to his reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and the application of blood so that the destroyer of the firstborn would not touch the firstborn of Israel. By faith, the people passed through the Red Sea as on dry land. But when the Egyptians tried to do so, they were drowned. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful to be here today. Thank you for each one that's come. Father, we ask that you give us understanding, that you open our eyes and our hearts to comprehend. And Father, that you will give us faith, that we will believe your word, that we'll understand, and your word will change us. Father, that we'll be different when we leave here. Father, I first pray for those that doesn't know Christ, if there may be a man or woman, boy or girl, that's never turned from their sins, never truly put their faith in Jesus and been born again. We pray today would be that day. Father, speak to your church. Grow us, edify us, and increase our faith, Father. Increase our love, and Father, make us the people that you're pleased with, the people you desire us to be. We ask this in Jesus' name.
You can make a wish. You can knock on.
I appreciate those kiddos there. All right. You'll turn back your Bibles to the book of Hebrews. So after that, let me ask you, how's your faith doing? I assume that during time of fellowship and so forth that you may have went up and shook somebody's hand and says, how are you feeling? But why do we do that when feelings are so fickle? We ought to ask, how are you faithing? Because faithing is what makes us steady. You know, we're only as strong as our faith. That's why the Bible tells us, according to your faith be it unto you. Now, today, as we get into this, I want to help you and I to understand, we're going to be talking about the redeeming blood of Christ. And I want us to help us to understand the power of our faith in Christ's shed blood. Okay? Now, to do that, we've got to speak about Moses this morning. And there's absolutely no doubt, Moses is one of the great heroes of faith. And you know, earlier, we read the entire section dealing with Moses there in Hebrews 11. But we're really only going to deal with one aspect of Moses. And it's therefore one verse, and that is verse 28, Hebrews 11, 28. By faith he, meaning Moses, by faith Moses, kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he who destroyed the firstborn should touch them. Now that's just one verse of Scripture, but we need to put it in context. It really doesn't mean a whole lot until you put it in context. So let's put it in context. The children of Israel are in Egypt. They're in bondage down there in slavery. Remember, they went down there many, many years before because of famine. Pharaoh was there, Joseph was there, but both of them have died. There's a new Pharaoh, and Joseph isn't around anymore. And it's a new Pharaoh who's enslaved the Hebrews. They are now in bondage there. They are now working, making bricks without straw. They're working day and night under cruel taskmasters. They're having the lash of the whip upon their back, and they are there enslaved. But God is going to bring them out. God is going to deliver them. Now, when God, the night that he brings them out is called the Passover. Now, what is the Passover? Well, God had told his people, the Hebrew people, that he's going to send an angel through the land, and this is going to be a death angel. And the death angel is going to go through the land, and he's going to kill every firstborn child of man and or beast. That's cruel, seems like. That's terrible. That's horrible there. But there is one exception. God said, you'll take a perfect male lamb, take its blood, and apply the blood to each side of the door and above the door. When the death angel comes through the land, and when he sees the blood, he'll pass over that house. And that's why we call it Passover. He passes over and does not bring judgment into that house. Now, this is not the time of year that we observe Passover. That's actually in the springtime around Easter when we celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it is our Jewish people and their faith that annually celebrate and observe Passover. But did you know, as Christians, we can and probably should observe and celebrate Passover here. Now, Easter and Passover are linked. They are inseparably, always interwoven, linked. And so a lot of people don't even realize that. But if you understand what Passover is, you'll be blessed because of what Passover is. Now, what we see in Passover is a picture. Is a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ coming. So the Passover is Calvary's sacrifice. When we talk about Calvary, we're talking about Jesus going to the cross. So Passover is Calvary's sacrifice anticipated. But then when Jesus came to the cross at Calvary, we see the sacrifice consummated. But then every time we observe the Lord's Supper, we're seeing that sacrifice celebrated. Those are our three main points today. All right? And I want you to get that and understand that as we go forward. Now, in Hebrews 11, 20, it says, by faith he, meaning Moses, kept the Passover. Now hear me. The Passover is all about a lamb. A lamb. Now we all like lambs. Whether you've been around them, held them, farmed them, touched them, whatever. They're cute, they're cuddly, they're white, they're soft, they're innocent, they're you know, helpless. You know, a lamb, in a way, kind of looks at you and I and says, are you hungry? Kill me and eat me. You know, are you cold? Shear my wool off and make a coat or make a blanket. You know, be warm. See, a lamb, if you kill one, it doesn't make a whole lot of noise. They can't fight you. They don't have horns to butt you. Their wobbly legs don't let them run very fast. They don't have claws to fight you, and they don't have incisor teeth to fight or bite you. They're almost just standing there saying, kill me. Now, God is going to use a lamb. He's going to use a lamb to deliver his people. Now, where are they? They're down in Egypt. What's going on? They're in bondage. They're in enslavement there. Now, Egypt in the Bible, because of what happened to the Hebrew people, stands for, symbolic of sin, the bondage of sin, the enslavement of sin, this world system, Satan's kingdom, and so forth. In fact, Pharaoh, who is the king of Egypt, is a type or symbolic of the devil himself. Now, let me show you something that you may not have ever thought about, may have not ever known. When you look at Egyptian art, you'll notice a snake or a serpent is involved in a lot. In fact, on the crown of Pharaoh, that thing sticking out there is a snake. So snakes or serpents have a significant role in Egyptian culture, art, religion, and so forth. And so you can say that a serpent or a snake is symbolic of Egypt. But then on the other corner is the lamb. There we have what God's going to use to defeat the serpent. God's little lamb, the Passover lamb. And that's what Passover is all about. The lamb defeating the serpent. This is how God is going to do this. We're going to see here. God's going to bring his people out of that land of bondage, out of cruelty, of wickedness, of sin. And he's going to bring them out by a lamb, the Passover lamb. Now keep that in mind as we go to point one. Point one is the prophetic anticipation of Calvary's sacrifice. Do you understand that Calvary was not an afterthought? That it was not an emergency action on the part of God. It was not plan B because plan A failed all of a sudden. No. Jesus and his mission to the cross was in the heart and mind of God long before God threw the stars and the planets out into the universe. And remember, Jesus flung those stars and planets out into the universe. And so when we look at the Calvary, the cross of Christ, it was all anticipated in the heart and mind of God long before creation, before anything else. Now, with that said, Hebrews 11 is the commentary. Remember, it is commenting on Old Testament stories. So Hebrews 11, we call it the commentary of the Old Testament. And so we're in Hebrews 11 talking about Moses and the Passover. So where's that story at? Exodus chapter 12. So turn over your Bibles to the book of Exodus chapter 12. And we're going to probably stay there. So just keep there most of the rest of the morning. We may go to some other verses here and there, but Exodus 12 will be there. So let's begin reading at verse 1. And we'll read at least to verse 11. Now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be your beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, on the 10th of this month, every man shall take for himself a lamb, according to the house of his father, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the persons, according to each man's need, you shall make your account for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. Now, you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight. And they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the house where they eat it. Then they shall eat the flesh on that night, roast it in fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Do not eat it raw, nor boiled at all with water, but roasted in fire, its head with its legs and its entrails. You shall let none of it remain until morning, and what remains of it until morning you shall burn with fire. Now verse 11, and thus you shall eat it with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. You shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. Now, that's the Lord speaking to Moses there. And do you notice? Lamb. We're talking about the lamb. A lamb here. A Passover lamb. Now, I want you to notice some things that when we compare and looking at here, some things about this lamb that anticipates the Lord Jesus Christ at Calvary. First of all, this is a spotless lamb. Right? You know, verse 5 says, your lamb shall be without blemish. It's a spotless lamb without any marks, anything. And again, this is a prophecy. This is a picture foretelling of Jesus coming, of our sinless Savior, Jesus. Now, they take this lamb on the 10th day, and they keep it up for 3 days. And they inspect it and look for any blemish, anything. They look from nose to tail. They look from ear to ear, eye to eye. They look at all the feet. They look on the belly. They look on the back. They look in the skin. I saw a picture of Jews doing that over in Israel in a video one time. And they literally pull the wool aside and look at all the skin. And they just go up and down every square inch of that, making sure, because if there's one blemish, one blow, one scab, one mistake, one scar, anything, that lamb doesn't count. It doesn't matter. It does not qualify as a sin sacrifice. So it must be a perfect male lamb without blemish. Absolute perfect now. Secondly, it's a sacrificial lamb. Look at verse 6. Now you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight. Now, it's actually going to die. It's actually going to be killed, this perfect, innocent lamb that's never done harm to anybody. They're going to kill it. Now, the father will probably take that lamb, raise his chin up, and take a sharp knife and go, shh. And the blood's going to come spurting out into a bowl, into a basin. You say, oh, that was gross. Why would God do that? Now, don't get all upset about it, because I know what some of y'all watch on TV. Don't you get grossed out on this subject. Some people won't preach the blood because it's gross, it's old, and so forth. The blood still saves. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. And so the Father takes it and understand this is all painting a picture to Calvary, to what Jesus does for us on the cross, that bloody Calvary. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. There is no forgiveness. There's no way our sins can be forgiven. There's no way our guilt can be paid for without the shedding, without the spilt blood of Christ for you and I. Third, the lamb's blood, or the lamb becomes a saving lamb. Verse 7, and they shall take some of the blood and put it on two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses, and they shall eat it. Now, move on down to verse 12, and we'll see what God says what happens at night. Verse 12 and 13, for I will pass through the land of Egypt on that night and will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. Now watch this. Now the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Now that's why we have Passover. This is what it's all about. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. So here we have a spotless lamb. A sacrificial lamb, a saving lamb. They take the blood and they apply it to both sides of the door and a top. Now, they use a little shrub called hyssop. They dip it in that bowl of blood and they sprinkle it or daub the doorpost and so forth. And it kind of looks like a cross when you think about it. All right? And so it's applied. Now, the blood of the lamb is applied there openly, publicly, unashamedly. There's no ifs and buts about it. The people inside that house believe in the blood. They've trusted the blood as their salvation, as their means of salvation. They couldn't apply that blood to the back door. They couldn't apply it to a closet door, the kitchen door. It wouldn't have worked. They couldn't put jewelry, gold or silver or diamonds or rubies on that door. It wouldn't have worked. They couldn't take a spotless, perfect lamb alive, maybe strap it up and tie it and nail it to the door. That wouldn't work. You understand, salvation is not by learning lessons from the living Christ. It is receiving life from the death of Christ. That's where salvation comes from. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. There is no forgiveness of sin. So when God sees the blood, he says, I'll pass over you. So we have a spotless lamb, a sacrificial lamb, a saving lamb. That is when the blood is applied to the door, the death angel will pass over. But fourth, this lamb is also a shared lamb. Look at verse 8 and 9. Then they shall eat the flesh of that on that night, roasted in fire, with unleavened bread and with bitter herbs, they shall eat it. Do not eat it raw, nor boiled at all with water, but roasted in fire, its head with its legs and its entrails. The whole lamb is to be roasted here. Now we're talking about a shared lamb. The whole family's to eat, not just the parents, not just the kids. Everybody's to eat this. Alright? And if it happens to be a smaller family with just mom and dad, maybe one or two children, then they could join in with another family next door and suffice and not be too, you know, too much, none is wasted here. But notice here, all the Hebrew people throughout the land is joining under this one experience. All these families have their own lambs. All of them are going through the same thing. They're all trusting in the blood here. Now, can you imagine the smell? The fires that roast, you know, cook, burning all night long, and the flesh that's burning, cooking, and roasting through the fire. You know, barbecue smells good. That's what we're having tonight. But I don't think we're having lamb. I think next time we ought to have some lamb in there. But anyway, it's basically the same thing. You cook the meat outdoors by wood. And so you can you imagine some 2,500,000, you know, 250,000, quarter million lambs cooking one night. They're all participating. They're all eating this. They're all feasting. Now, why? Here's a group of slaves that's becoming a nation. Here's a group of people that's experiencing and fellowshipping together around the Feast of the Lamb. They're all going to eat the lamb here. That means when you and I receive Jesus Christ, you and I receive all of Jesus. We don't get to pick and choose what part of Jesus we want. He is the master. He's the Messiah. He is the mediator. And so we don't get to say, well, I'll take a little of that salvation part of Jesus, but I don't want any of that lordship stuff. No. No, we take all of Jesus or we don't get any of Jesus. All right? They were there to eat all them, but then also eat with bitter herbs and unleavened bread. Now, bitterness speaks of the brokenness and the bitter regrets of life. They've been a slave in Egypt for a long time. And it's been a bitter life here. Have you ever wept over your sins? Have you ever felt bitterness in your heart because you realize how egregious your guilt has been before God? You've been enslaved to your own sins. Listen, before we can eat of that lamb, before we can take of Christ, there must be bitterness there. There must be regret. The Bible tells us godly sorrow produces repentance. We cannot have salvation without repentance. We must acknowledge, take the bitters of the herbs with the unleavened bread. Now, leaven, in the Bible, leaven is symbolic of sin. It is, throughout the Bible, this little leaven. Now, most of us know that leaven is yeast. And you put yeast in dough and it causes it to rise. It becomes a loaf of bread or cake and so forth here. But it doesn't take much. And it grows in our lives. But during Passover, there can be no leaven. It's all gone. This is unleavened bread that we're supposed to have. But as we think about this, so they're to feed on this lamb with bitter herbs and unleavened bread here. And so this tells us they're to be broken over their sins and broken from. There's no sin in life. They get rid of it. Clean up. All right? So they eat all this lamb and it's to be roasted. Now, why roasted? Because of the fires of God's wrath is going to burn out on Christ our Lord, our Savior, our Lamb, our sacrifice. Now, when they had this celebration, when they participate here, there's also no work. Look at verse 16. On the first day, there shall be a holy convocation, and on the seventh day, there shall be a holy convocation for you. No manner of work shall be done on them, but they which everyone must eat, they that only may be prepared by you. In other words, the only work that could be done is in preparation for this special day. Now, what is God teaching us? It is not by works of righteousness that we have done, but by his mercy he saved us. God is saying, if you're going to eat my lamb, if you're going to take my salvation, You just eat it. Don't bring any works into this. Just trust me. Accept my sacrifice. Accept one I'm giving you here. You know, accept here. Verse 11 says, and thus you shall eat it with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. So you shall eat it in the house. It is the Lord's Passover. In other words, this isn't a one-time thing. This isn't over with here and done. This is the beginning. This is not over here. Heard about a preacher who's performing a wedding, and as a young couple, and the pastor and the young man was young. He was almost like a boy, very naive, and he was scared to death getting married. And finally got past the I do's, and the young man says, Pastor, is it all over? And the pastor looked at him and says, no, it's not over. It's just beginning for you. Listen, when you give your heart to Christ, when you trust him as your Lord and Savior, you truly get born again, it's the new day for you. It's just the beginning. It's not just get it done and over with and no more. You have now all tomorrows, no yesterdays. It's now to the future. It's a new beginning, a new life in our world. And so we look here in verse 2, it says, the month shall be your beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year. When you truly give your life to Christ, when you trust him as Lord and Savior, it's a brand new day in life. Now, so what do we set here? The Passover lamb is a spotless lamb, a sacrificial lamb, a saving lamb, and a shared lamb. All that is in anticipation to Calvary. Isn't God's word wonderful? Because think about what it's doing here. It's painting us a picture, preparing us for the day that Jesus is the Lamb of God. So that brings us to point two, the promised consummation of Calvary's sacrifice. This lamb has been prophesied up to this point, that Jesus will come and be that sacrificial lamb. Jesus is the Lamb of God. I remind you, John the Baptist, God's forerunner, you know, the forerunner of Christ. He was there at the Jordan River, and he was baptizing, and he looked up and saw Jesus come and said, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Now, Moses knew this. Moses knew back there when this was all initiated, this is all prophetic, this is all painting a picture, this is all symbolic. John the Baptist knew when he was doing this and seeing Jesus coming, that everything prior to this was all prophetic, all symbolic, all coming about. Now, I want you to see or compare here the Passover lamb with Christ. The Passover lamb was spotless. Jesus is spotless. In 1 Peter 1:18 and 19, it says, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ. Now listen to this very carefully. As of a lamb without blemish, without spot. Do you see how it all ties together here? God said to Moses, Moses, get a lamb. Moses had a lamb, that Passover lamb. Then Mary had a lamb. You know that Mary had a lamb, his fleece is white as snow. We're talking about Jesus, the spotless lamb of God. Now, remember, they took this Passover lamb, they put it up on the 10th day of the month and kept it up for three days. Why? So they can inspect it. So they can look it over and so forth and examine it thoroughly here. Look for any flaw, because in 3 days they should be able to find all the flaws and either qualify or disqualify here. Now, have you ever wondered why the Gospels spend so much time and focus on the last week of Jesus' life? Maybe a third of the Gospels, and especially the last 3 days of his life. 3 days of inspection. 3 days of his life as he comes. Now, during Old Testament times leading up to this, it's supposedly here the Hebrews began to do something, because they had such a difficult time finding Passover lambs. You would think about that. You have to find an absolute 100% perfect lamb. How hard, how difficult would that be? So what they began to do is find some shepherds, be Passover shepherds, you might say. Their whole job was to produce Passover, perfect lambs. So they would take the best ewes, the best rams in the land, and breed them, and hopefully produce perfect lambs. And so they would have flocks of Passover shepherds taken care of and trying to produce perfect Passover lambs. Now, these were Passover lambs, and therefore they were born to die. Think about that. That's the whole purpose, is to die. Now, also something that is a probability here. When the angels appeared to the angels in the fields around Bethlehem, do you know where the shepherds were that took care of these flocks? Bethlehem. That's where the spotless lambs came from, was the Bethlehem area. So the night the angels came and announced Mary's lamb on Christmas night, those very same shepherds were probably the Passover shepherds. Now, come Passover, it was time to bring the lambs to Jerusalem, to bring them up about 5 miles. They'd come through the sheep gate into Jerusalem toward the Temple Mount there. And they would be brought to the priest, who would then examine and prove that they were absolutely perfect. Now, at the same time that those lambs were coming into the city, guess where Jesus was at? He was coming in the city from the other direction, going to the Temple Mount. This is when we call Palm Sunday. Remember when they all are hollering and saying, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And they're laying out the clothes and the palm branches before Jesus. You know, we also call that the triumphal entry. So Jesus comes in the eastern gate, going to the triumphal, to the temple there. And so for 3 days, they are examining these Passover lambs. But for 3 days, they're examining Jesus. Remember all the criticism and all the harping and carping and fault finding and so forth. Even the religious elite and the civil authorities and Pilate said, I find no fault in him. And everything that was accused of him, they could not prove. They could not convince him of sin because he was spotless. And he would die in our place. He would die for our sins. Now Jesus goes eventually to Gethsemane. But before then, he says to his disciples, says, we're going to celebrate Passover. He says, let's go prepare a feast. Go prepare the upper room. And so we call that the Last Supper, but it's actually Passover, right? Now, they go to that upper room, and remember the story. We observed the Lord's Supper 2 weeks ago. And Jesus takes some bread, some unleavened bread, and he blesses it, and he breaks it, and he gives it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Now, up to that point, and still to this day, the Jews created a tradition. For about 3 centuries prior to this, they began at Passover, take a cloth bag called a matzah tosh. Matzah is the bread, the unleavened bread. That's what it's called, matzah bread. But so they had a bag that's called a matzah tosh. And had 3 pockets. And in the center pocket would be matzah or unleavened bread. And so as everybody's gathered around the Passover table, the father of the house would reach into that matzah tosh, pull out some matzah bread, some unleavened bread. He would bless it. He would break it and distribute it to each person there. Then he'd take whatever was left over and wrap it in a napkin and bury it for later use. They didn't know they were preparing for the resurrection. But that's what they were doing. Now, it's no doubt Jesus probably did the exact same thing. He had the disciples there. He reaches into a matzah tosh, pulls out the bread. He blesses it. And he says, this is my body. He breaks it and distributes it. There in Matthew 26, it says, and as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. Now, I'll come back to this, but Jesus is going to leave that upper room. And where's he going? Out to be judged, to the judgment, and unto the crucifixion. And that is into where? Mount Moriah. Now, also remember, a couple weeks ago, we dealt with Abraham and Isaac going to Mount Moriah because God had charged Abraham to take his only son, the son whom he loved, and kill him on Mount Moriah. But Isaac didn't have to die. Why? Because God prepared a substitute, a ram there. And so why did Isaac not die? God had prepared. Now remember, this is a prophecy too. This is all foretelling because Isaac said, Father, here's the fire, here's the wood, where's the lamb? And Abraham says, God will provide himself a sacrifice, a lamb. All right? And he did. His name is Jesus. Now, do you think all this is just incidental? Do you think this is just by accident that God put all these shapes and figures and symbols and all these prophecies together for centuries and centuries and bring them all together here? That it just happened that there on Mount Moriah, the same place where Jesus would die, that Abraham was there and that he would offer Isaac, but then it would be substituted? Think about all this. There at the temple, the Passover lambs are ready. They've been chosen. The priests have a sharpened knife, and they will slit the throat of that lamb, drain the blood. At the same time, outside the gate, still on Mount Moriah, God's lamb will be hanging on a cross. And there he will bow his head and say, "It is finished. It's all over. It's done. Levites, you're no longer needed. Go home. Priests, you're no longer needed. Go home. Passover shepherds, go home. You're no longer needed here." All that has been anticipated has now been consummated. Christ, the Lamb of God, has died for our sins. It's finished. It's over with here. He is the sacrificial lamb. He is the perfect, spotless lamb, the sacrificial lamb, the saving lamb, and the shared lamb. Just as they ate of those lambs for centuries upon centuries, we eat upon Jesus every day by faith. We take of him and his blood and what he did. Now, if I had planned things out better, I would have preached this 2 weeks ago when we did the Lord's Supper. But it's still fresh in our minds, and we need to understand this. So this comes to our third point, the perpetual celebration of Calvary's sacrifice. So we talked about how Jesus' sacrifice was anticipated through all the symbolism, all the stories, and all of the Old Testament. Then it's consummated when Jesus went to the cross. But now we're going to talk about celebration. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 7 and 8 tells us, and this is Paul speaking to the church at Corinth, "Therefore purge out the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened, for indeed Christ our Passover was sacrificed for us." So when we come to the Lord's table here, when we come to the Lord's Supper here, we're keeping that feast. Now, some may say, "Well, you're stretching this too far. You're reading too much in it." If I am, Paul definitely was, all right? Because he says, "Christ our Passover was sacrificed for us, therefore let us keep the feast." So we keep the Passover through the Lord's Supper, all right? "Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth." Now, when we take the Lord's Supper, it's all symbolism. We still use unleavened bread, all right? And we use this unleavened bread, no leaven, which represents sin. But then we also take the pure blood of the grape, and that represents the blood of Christ. Now we use unleavened bread. In fact, let me just remind you, we're using kosher matzah bread. All right? That's stuff that's broken up and everything when we serve. Sometimes people say, "Well, why don't we use real wine?" Do you realize that wine has leaven in it? It has yeast. And it, grape juice, in other words, doesn't. And so we have no leaven whatsoever. I think the Jews would do the same thing. They had plain grape juice, not all of us wine. And so we don't use the leavened wine, if you will. Now, the Jews, when they had their cedar, their Passover meal, they have another little tradition. The father would be preparing the table, getting everything ready. The kids would be outside. And he will take a crumb or two of actual leavened bread that has the yeast in it and hide it in the room, maybe on a mantle, on a bookshelf, or under a pillow on the couch or something like that. And when he's all ready, he'll call the kids and says, "Now, find the leaven." And they would start searching. And somebody finds it. "Papa, Paul, here's a leavened crumb." And he'd come over maybe with a feather and a spoon and sweep it into it and then take it and throw it outside. Why? Because there's not supposed to be any leaven whatsoever in the house. In fact, the Bible talks about sweeping the house to get the leaven out. And it's all symbolic, all right? In fact, if you ever get to live next door to an Orthodox Jew that observes Passover, and you become friends with them, they may come and ask you the week before Passover, "Can we bring our leaven and leave it in your house until after Passover?" Because they can't have it in their house during Passover. There's nothing wrong with actual physical leaven. All right, it's not sinful in itself. It's all symbolic. But they will get it out of their house and store it, and then after Passover, bring it back. Now, what is God saying in all this? When you come to the Lord's table, we're to come with clean hearts. We're to come with repentant sin, that we come confessing and repenting of our sins and be clean before him, because we are celebrating the sinless, the spotless life of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Now listen to these scriptures that I usually read before Lord's Supper. In 1 Corinthians 11:23, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death.'" Hallelujah. "And he, until he comes." He died, but he lives. He lives and he's coming back. Folks, we're celebrating. We're not mourning a corpse. We are hailing the conqueror. Jesus Christ has won the victory. The Lamb has defeated the serpent. And folks, of all people who ought to be celebrating, it ought to be us. The Lord's Supper is about celebrating. Yes, it's serious because all its symbolism is serious. But it is also remind us we are victors. We're no longer slaves. We're no longer slaves to sin. We are free. Isn't the Bible wonderful? And you think about it, how God has taken all the symbology and all the prophecy and all these little things, those intricate details and painted pictures all through the Old Testament and brought it to Jesus in Calvary and even to you and I today. What a blessing it is to know God's word is there for you and I. I love Christ. I love the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you? I love him and I'm so thankful for his precious blood. In the Old Testament, when the Passover was first initiated, one of the things that they did by putting the blood on the doorpost was saying, "We trust in the blood. I put my faith in God's word here. He said, put the blood, I'm going to believe him." In the New Testament, it tells us we must confess Christ publicly. In Romans chapter 5, verse 9 and 10, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. If you truly trust Christ, if you truly believe he's the Lord and Savior, you will tell it. You will share that. You will declare that to the world unashamedly. Now, if you're not saved, you really need to be. In fact, if you're not saved, you really have nothing to look forward to. You have no celebration. Nothing. Because the death angel isn't going to pass over until he sees the blood. Now, how do you apply the blood of Christ to your life? By faith. By faith. Romans 5:1, "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." Have you ever put Christ on the throne of your life? Have you ever trusted him? Have you ever trusted his sacrifice for your salvation? Not your good works, not being a Baptist, not being a religious person, but trusted Jesus, what he accomplished on the cross, and trusted him to be your Lord and Savior. Heads bowed, eyes closed. If you realize that you need Christ as your Lord and Savior, now's the time. As we come this invitation time, we invite you, we encourage you to come and say, "I want to be saved. I want Jesus to be my Lord and Savior." And we'll walk through the scriptures. We'll show you what you need to do to invite Christ in your heart to be saved. If you're saved, have you confessed those sins? Are you clean before him? Do you walk each day in the joy of Christ, in the sacrifice? Are you clean before him and walking each day? Father, I ask you to speak to each heart. Draw us unto you. Give us understanding. Change us. Make us the people that you want us to be. In Jesus' name I ask and pray. Amen.
156.
so stay and join us and let us sit down and talk and visit and just fellowship. Because that's what it's really about, is getting to sit down and enjoy each other's company and fellowship with one another. Don't forget, coming the 28th, that week from tomorrow, is our prayer day. And we encourage you to fast if you're physically able to, but especially pray. Alright? And we're going to have a prayer time here at church from 7 in the morning to 7 in the evening. And we invite you to come and kneel and pray for 30 minutes during that day to pray for our nation, pray for our world, pray for souls, pray for your family, pray for our schools. There's a lot of things to pray for. And so I hope that you'll sign up on the bulletin board. There is a list there and find time slots that fits your schedule and sign up and then that day come and pray. Will you? We need to fill that up and really have a full day of prayer and fasting for our nation, for our world. All right? Anything else?
If you're interested in being in the Christmas play, please come see me, okay?
All right, that's coming up. We need people to be part of that. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful to be here today. Thank you for each one. We pray now that we discuss that you'll bless the food and the fellowship that's to follow. Watch over and protect us and speak to us today. We pray that in all things that Jesus be glorified and lifted up, and that we as your people be faithful to your word. Give us courage and wisdom and follow the joy to share and invite others to Christ and just to lift up the name of Jesus in our daily life. And we ask now, bless the food, the meal, and all things this afternoon. We ask in Jesus' name.
Amen. Hymn 6. Praise God.